Hey, it's Fran, and time again for another Pencils and Pens video for fall of 2018. Got some new pens and pencils I wanted to show you, and as always, no paid reviews, I just review what I like, and so nothing but my honest opinion. So let's take a look. Alright, there's a brand new Palomita Blackwing they've come out with. It's their 33 and a third edition, and it's pretty cool. All black, with even the lettering is all black and embossed. That's just so cool. Just black embossed lettering, and in the front has this vinyl track kind of groove in the front, reminiscent of looking at 33 and a third LP, and the divisions between the songs. It gives a very tactile feel. It's pretty intriguing. Palominos, they come with all kinds of different editions every now and then, with different colors, different kinds of graphite, different kinds of erasers. The cool thing is you can customize them, because you can also like get the erasers in virtually any color that you want and make the pencils have exactly the color combinations that you want with erasers and pencils. And with all the Palominos, they have the completely removable, changeable, adjustable eraser, so that as the eraser wears down, you can extend it out. You know, you just take it out of the holder. It's got these little jaws. You can extend it out a little bit, put it back in as you wear the eraser down. And if you're like me and go through erasers faster than you actually go through the pencil, you can put a completely new eraser right on it and finish the pencil all the way down to the nub if you want. So yeah, the Palominos, they're just a lot of fun. They're not cheap, but I find that you really get what you pay for. If you use pencils all the time, if you really like writing with pencils as I do, you will find that the Palomino is top of the heap. So, but yeah, the 33 and a third, I like this a lot. I'd say that my favorite so far out of the Palominos is the number 73. And every time you get a box of Black Wings, they come in this collector's case. Yeah, it's a 73. I guess the reason the 73 is my favorite so far is because of the tactile. Again, they're embossed. But this is actually raised, this pattern. Gives it this really intense tactile feel that I've really never had with any other pencil. And of course the color, it's really nice, lake blue. It's just, I like all the Black Wings, but the 73 so far has given me the most pleasant experience. Again, it's got to be that combination of color and tactile feel. That's sort of why I like the 33 and a third, because they've done the same thing with having these grooves in the front and the matte black all around. Very vinyl. So yeah, cool. But yeah, I mean, Palominos, it's sort of collecting Palominos is like it becomes a hobby. I started out just liking the pencils, but now when they come out with an edition that I really like, I end up buying a box, and now I sort of live with them. But anyway, that's it for the new pencils. In the new affordable fountain pens category, I found this new, I don't know if they're new, but they're new to me, a new kind of entry-level fountain pen called the Uli. This one's called a Splendid Pen. And I sort of like this off the rack. I like the really simple kind of minimalistic packaging. And I was attracted to the basic all-around design of the pen. I think it's got a very classic fountain pen shape. And it's got the pull-off cap, which makes it real easy. A little clickety cap. And it comes with cartridges included. I'm not sure if they have refillable options with the Uli, but it's really meant to be a starter pen, a sort of a beginner fountain pen. There's a little ball in the cartridge there, so that when you put it in, it kind of snaps and that ball goes inside the inkwell. There it goes. I like the basic all-around look, transparent thing, and these are very affordable. I think I paid about $5 or $6 for this one. Get the ink started, a fresh pen. When you first start a pen, it might take a little while getting the ink all the way down through to the nib. Oh, here we go. It's pretty good. It's got a kind of a, yeah, the ink is good that comes with it. It's got a good writability. I think this is feels like a medium tip. But there's good ink delivery and flow. Again, this is for a starting pen. It's very good. You quick strokes. It's got good ink delivery. So all good signs of a well-designed fountain pen. If you can move quickly, and if you don't have dropouts when you do a quick move, that's a good sign of a good fountain pen. But yeah, no, I've got a couple of these. Keep them around the shop in different colors. And yeah, I would. It's got a little rubber gripper on the front, so you know, if you're a student, it's good student writer, or good for an office kind of desktop pen. The great thing about these sort of entry-level fountain pens is they're pretty functional, and if you put it in your pocket and end up leaving it somewhere, you're not going to cry about it because it's you know, a $5 pen. I'd reviewed the Varsity before, the Pilot Varsity. I'd say these are kind of on par with each other as far as like reliability and such, and writability. The Varsity has kind of the same thing where, you know, the ink delivery is good. Now this pen has been sitting around a while, so it's a little jumpy, but yeah, if I start it up again, here we go. So that's another quality is with a fountain pen is the reliability. If you leave the pen sit for a while, how well does it write right out of the gate? With most fountain pens, you haven't written with it in a couple weeks or a couple months and it's got ink in it, you might have to give it a little shake and maybe, you know, write a little squiggle line or something on some scratch paper to get the ink going full flow. But, you know, the Pilot Varsity is pretty reliable. I carry these in my bag and I might not use it for a couple of weeks at a time, and they're pretty reliable with just occasional use. I haven't had the Ulis long enough to really know about the reliability, but you know, for a starting level really cheap pen, you really can't go wrong. But yeah, but I like it. I like the Uli. I think it's a good design. Gets thumbs up. Here's another one I wanted to go back to. I reviewed this before. This is the Twisby, which I had said in the review, because I didn't know anything about this company. I said in the review that I thought it was a terrible name for a company, the TWSBI. And I think I made comments something to the effect of, oh, you know, it's not the kind of a company name that you would really talk to a friend about, oh, I got that new TWSBI pen, yada yada. But people have told me in the comments, no, it's pronounced Twisby. You're supposed to say Twisby, which is fine. I think that just from a marketing standpoint, I think they should just change the name to Twisby. If that's the case, just call it, just, you know, write Twisby on it, and that would be fine. But I was a little hard on this pen. I didn't like the idea of the internal, like, built-in piston. I worried about leaking. I didn't like the way that the sort of it's unscrewed from the end without any lock on it, because I thought, you know, it'd be easy to like unscrew that and get it to leak, or to, you know, force the ink, get it to squirt through the nib, something like that. I wasn't really sure about the all-around design with the screw-on cap. So, you know, yeah, I had a lot of criticisms of this, but honestly, I've used this pen for over a year, and I did find that it's very reliable. It's a very reliable pen. My concerns about the leaking of the reservoir, although I still look at it and wonder when that's going to leak, it hasn't ever leaked. And they give you a little bit of grease to grease up the piston when you refill the pen, so I guess if it's properly maintained, it would not necessarily ever leak. But I have to say, one advantage of this design with the built-in sort of piston reservoir is that with this particular pen, you get the largest like ink reservoir of any fountain pen that I've ever owned. I think I actually use this pen every week, and I went through an entire year before I had to refill it, which I think is pretty amazing for a fountain pen. This has also turned out to be a very reliable pen. Again, that reliability factor of if you leave a fountain pen sitting around for days, weeks, or even months, and you pick it up and start writing with it, how reliable is it? This one is surprisingly good. There are two criticisms of the Twisby that I still remain for me. One is the screw-on cap, which I know a lot of people who have fountain pens say, oh, you want the screw-on cap because you don't want it to leak, yada yada. But I gotta be honest with you, every fountain pen that I'll ever use or review or compare is measured against the Parker 51. This is the end-all be-all of all pens, not just fountain pens. Very famously, click-on cap with the patented seal. And so yeah, I as far as writability, reliability, usability, and every other respect, every pen that I ever will use is compared to the Parker 51. This one's from 1947. It's a very pretty typical Parker 51. It's got the bar type, squeezy type refill bladder. There were other types that had the piston, which had a little kind of a little plunger on the end. But this is the bladder fill, which is very easy to use. But the Parker is, you know, it's the end-all be-all of pens. It's the greatest pen ever made. It's always going to be the pen by which all other pens are compared. So the idea of requiring a twist-on cap on a fountain pen is ridiculous. You know, the 51 pulled it off a long time ago with the snap-on cap. The Lamy's, which I use every day, again, reliability, flow, the feel and everything. The Lamy's are still, I still consider these to be like the best utilitarian and most rugged fountain pens. The Safaris, I own lots of these Safaris, and again, they've got a rubber seal gasket on there. It's a click-on, click-off cap, and it's got a, you know, the seal on the front and, you know, a tight seal in the back. And, you know, I've never had one leak on a table or anywhere else. It keeps the ink on the end. Even if I've dropped them on the floor and everything, they don't splatter. So, yeah, the idea of requiring a screw-on, screw-off cap is just untrue. You know, a well-designed pen can be made, obviously, with a click-on cap. But the other thing about the Twisby that I'm still kind of getting used to is the feel of the nib, because it does have a grabby feel. In fact, you can even hear the sound it makes. I'll get the microphone close. See that? That's the sound of friction. So if I do the Parker 51, it's just, it glides. The Parker has a ruthenium nib, a rare earth metal. I don't know if anyone else ever used ruthenium in a pen nib, but you know, the specific alloy, the kind of metallurgy in the nib that's used, it, and also the finish. I mean, the Twisby has a very bright finish, so I mean, without knowing anything about it, it almost seems like it's a chrome type finish. I would doubt that it's polished stainless, but it is a very brilliant gleam on it. So I don't know if it's plated, but whatever they're using, it has a grippy feel on the paper, and I just don't like that in a fountain pen. I mean, you might not care, or you might find that to be fine, but the Lamy's have a very different composition. Again, they're quiet. It's completely silent. So, you know, the very specific metallurgy of the nib has a lot to do with the feel of the pen on the paper, and I've used the Twisby, you know, almost every day for like occasional notations for over a year, and it's a good performing pen, but I just wish they would get a better nib, and I wish that they would And if they went with some kind of a click-on cap, it would be, you know, an easier, sort of more civilized pen. But on the plus side, that big reservoir, if you use a pen a lot, that goes a long, long way. I just wish that it had a better feel when writing, that I would have probably been using it a whole lot more if it felt anywhere as good as the Lamy or the Parker. But anyway, that's my update on the Twisby and the shootout of my favorite pens, the Parker being number one of all time. Always will be number one of all time. Never, I don't think the Parker 51 will ever be exceeded. It's just a marvel of engineering and design and art all merged into one. It's never going to be, there's just never going to be a better pen than the Parker 51. So, in my opinion. All right, so I don't do paid reviews, but occasionally people do contact me with something that they make and want to know my honest opinion, and I say, sure, I'll give you my honest opinion. And this package came in from Dryden Designs. I don't know anything about the company or the company history, although it is a British company, but they make fountain pens, among other things, and sent me a pen, which I have not even opened the package. They sent me a random pen with some cartridges, I see. I thought I would check it out. So I get certificate of authenticity, warranty registration. I don't know if I would ever like warranty a pen, but not too bad. Pack of 24 ink cartridges. Yeah. Oh, these are a little smaller. Yeah, they're a little petite, a little smaller than typical cartridges I get in my disposable pens. But yeah, nice. I like the little carrying pouch. It's a nice touch. Minimalistic packaging, something you might keep rather than throw out. It's always a good thing. Okay. Ooh. Okay. Wow, that's pretty brilliant. Yeah. Wow. That is a very brilliantly turned metal pen. Yeah. Feels like stainless. All right. It's got some nice details. Gold accents. Looks like real gold plating. Ooh, I like that. Snap-on cap. It's got a plastic sleeve inside, I can see. Inside there. Try that again. Oh, that's a real positive feel. Yeah, I do like that a lot. All right. Oh, okay. It's got the refillable piston. That's nice. Yep. That's what I prefer, just like in my Lamy's. I do like the refillable cartridge. It looks like the little ball is in there. I don't know if they do that to mix the ink, or if it's just that these cartridges all come standard with the ball filling the end sort of out of the factory, and you just end up with the ball inside. But I don't know. It's a new modern thing I'm finding with all the new cartridge pens. But I do prefer this kind of piston reservoir, because you can remove it from the pen, put it right in the inkwell, and just draw it up, and it makes it real easy to refill a fountain pen. I do end up putting those kinds of reservoirs in all my pens, like the Lamy. Yeah, so, but yeah, it's the method I really prefer is with the piston type cartridge. That's all metal, so. Say I don't really buy too many fountain pens that are this fancy. I try using their regular cartridge. Yeah, I put a great deal of force in there. I don't want to damage the pen, but that is really just not Yeah, I don't want to break that internal piece there, but that's a very tight fit. I can't really get that to snap. No. No, I don't want to break that, because that is a plastic piece in there. I'm not exactly sure how much force I'm supposed to have to apply to that little ball to get it to pop in, but I don't want to break that little, tiny little plastic nib in there. So, So rather than going that route, I'm going to just fill up a cartridge with some ink. I've got some Burgundy Mont Blanc, which they do make very good ink. I don't own any Mont Blanc pens, but I can already see a problem with this having this captive ball in the, is that the, it does prevent you from putting the piston all the way forward. Good fit. Yeah, I don't know why this cartridge is so hard to start. But yeah, that obviously the amount of force needed to push that ball in there, I'm just concerned that it's would damage the inside of the pen if I pushed any harder than I was pushing. One of the things that I tend to do when I'm writing with a fountain pen is when I take the cap off, I'll put the cap around the back in the Parker style, and one thing I noticed with this, just with the shape, because it's got this taper to the end, but it's got this plastic sleeve on the inside, and when I put the cap on the back, there's no like shoulder for it to rest on, so it's a little it's not really like a fit. I mean, obviously you could push it on really tight, but when I put it in my hand, it just sort of came loose and cap would just kind of fall off. There's no like positive like fit for the cap to be on the back, so that's I don't know, that's sort of a functional thing for me, having the if the cap fits really well on the back, but I don't know, it's a little wobbly on the end. I don't like that, but anyway. All right. Well, I have to say the ink delivery is really good. And the feel of the nib is very good. It's got, definitely has that smooth feel that I like. It's very velvety smooth. So, the ink delivery is very good. Ooh. I find that because I write the cursive F, I find that it's a good test of a pen. Just that little crest in the F is definitely, for all the pens that I use, if a pen's going to skip, it skips like right in that area when I switch directions in writing the F. So I found with testing a pen and its writability, just doing that sort of shape is a good test. I definitely give it top marks for readability. There's no question about that. As soon as I got the cartridge in there, I just gave it a little shake and it was writing pretty much right away. So there's very good flow to the nib. The weight of the pen I like. I will say that I like the weight of it. I like the clickety cap. I do think there should be some kind of a shoulder or something in the interior piece. Like with the Parker, there's a very similar thing where the Parker doesn't have, there's no shoulder on the back, but the interior of the cap is designed in such a way that when you put it on the back, it just, the taper of the inside of the cap and the taper of the barrel, they go together and it's very snug. It doesn't wiggle, it won't come off. It's just, again, that's a very good, well thought out design. And to retain the cap, similar with the Lamy, it's got the same kind of situation where you've got a clickety cap, but when you put it on the back, the taper between the two, between the barrel and the cap, is so similar that they just you know, click right on. It's never going to come off. It's never going to fall off. So, yeah, I know it can be done. Yeah, I mean, this is, I don't know what this pen costs, I give it high marks for writability. I definitely like the refillable piston reservoir. The cartridges that I'm just picking one at random, I'd say that the cartridges that with the pre-filled ink, this particular one was just too tight. I would have, you know, I would be very hesitant to apply more pressure to pop that ball in, because you wouldn't want to damage that really fine little receptacle on the inside. But some other pens that take these kind of cartridges that I've had in the past will have a shoulder on the inside of the barrel so that when you screw it on, it actually pops it in place. This pen doesn't have that because it takes the longer reservoir. So yeah, I don't know, this didn't work, but you know, you really don't ever use these in a fine pen. If you have fountain pens, you refill them yourself. I mean, that's just what people do. You don't really use this type of cartridge in a fine desk pen, I don't think. But so yeah. So Dryden Designs, I thank you for the pen to try out. I'd say it's a fine pen. I think what I'll do is you know, sit it on the desk, use it every now and then, and over time be able to, you know, assess reliability. As far as, you know, if you set the pen down, don't use it for a week, and then, you know, pick it up. You know, when you put the pen down, is it delivering ink like right on demand, or do you have to shake it, or does the tip dry out? These are things that I tend to care about in fountain pens, and the fountain pens that I tend to keep around and use are ones that are very reliable, where if you set it aside for a while, it can be even weeks. In the case of like something like the Parker or the Lamy, they can sit for weeks without being used, and you know, when you pick it up, it'll deliver right on demand, no worries. So anyway, but yeah, all around, some, you know, this is a new company. I think that they'll probably get the kinks out of their designs, but I'd say right out of the gate, it's a very fine writing pen overall. So. All right. Okay, and another company that I've gotten some writing instruments from recently is a company called E plus M out of Germany. And they're a very old company, although they're very new to me. But I've got a couple of things. I've got this flex nib quill pen. You know, it's a steel flex nib pen. And also this graphite holder, which is used for doing rough sketching, and also when you're painting on canvases, a graphite holder like this is used very traditionally in painting to do your outlines and guidelines and such on more coarse materials like canvas. But I really like the design sensibility of this of the products, and so I've been sort of collecting things from them that I like, and I really like this graphite holder a great deal, especially the fact that it actually will hold the graphite inside, so you won't damage it by carrying it around, and then it's right on demand, like a good mechanical pencil, but with a, you know, very large graphite core. But I just like the combination of you know, minimal packaging combined with designs that are evocative of very classic tools, with a very modern design sensibility with the color combinations and such. That's sort of what I like about these two things. I like the green sort of stained wood barrel of the graphite holder, and I liked this sort of very classic sort of swirl sort of pattern. I don't know exactly what they're called, but the patterns inside of, you know, old books where they used to float oil on water and do these sorts of elaborate random patterns. But the thing about this too, the flex nib on this E plus M pen is also very classic feel. So the classic nib. The ink delivery is very classic. With quills and nibs, which behave kind of similarly, you have a little reservoir here. When you dip it, there's this little recess in the, well, the nib, I should say, because people who are writing aficionados will say, you can't call that a quill, you have to call that a nib, and this is a quill. And the two are very different, which is true. A nib is made out of metal, and it's flexible, and has a little dimple in there, some way of holding the ink. And generally you get a little more, you get better ink control in a flex nib than you do in a quill, typically. But the way that the ink is delivered with this particular nib, I like a lot. So with a goose quill, it's sort of the same. My handwriting style is really set up for fountain pens, but the quill, it's a much, you have to write slower, definitely. And I'm also not really accustomed to the resistance. With a quill, it has a, I'm going to get the mic real close so you can hear it. Get the mic down here close so you can hear it. So it has that squealy kind of feel. It's a definitely different kind of writing. You have to write slowly, and you can't, like, you have to apply like a medium amount of pressure. If you write too light, I found, at least with the quills I have, if you write too lightly, it can, you know, it may not start. But yeah, oh, look at this. And also you do tend to blob the, say I just dropped a blob of ink because I overdipped it. Another issue with quills. Yeah, if I sit down to write something with a quill, I really have to take my time. The quills can be kind of hard to start. There you go. And then, see, it wasn't starting, so I leaned into a little too much and opened up the nib a little bit, and bloop, got a little blob. So yeah, it's definitely takes a lot of skill to write with a goose quill. I think you'd have to do it all the time, and I almost think that you'd have to have your quills adjusted for your writing style. But yeah, you can't lean into them like you can with a fountain pen. It's just not forgiving. It's a challenge. I just really don't have that much, I haven't spent that much time writing with goose quills because they are so, like, I guess I just don't have the time. I guess if I had a lot of free time, I'd probably spend a lot more time trying to master it. But it's definitely not the kind of pen that you can just use and make like a writable letter with, as opposed to like a nib pen, which pretty much is dip and write. So it's one of the reasons that once the flex nibs came out in the mid-19th century, no one was using goose quills anymore, because it was just so much easier to write with a flex nib pen, and you had a lot more ink in the tip, and you could be a lot faster with the writing style, so you could write faster and yada yada, and you could write a really long line. It would deliver lots of ink with one dip. So with a goose quill, you might have to actually dip it every single word, or every single, you know, maybe every four letters or so, you have to re-dip it. But with a flexi nib, you could go a pretty long way and write a really long line with just one dip. And it's a lot harder. You don't necessarily get the splattering. It's not as easy to drop a blob of ink on the paper with a flex nib as it is with a quill. But yeah, but I enjoyed this pen a lot. I've been using it, especially with this vintage inkwell that I like to use. It sits on the stand really well, so it's a merging of the old and the new with this pen. So yeah, but E&M, I look forward to exploring some other stuff that they might come out with in the future, combining the old and the new, which I'm very much approve of. Well, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks too to all my patrons. They make all these videos possible. And thank you. If you like what I do, if you like my videos, consider becoming a patron. It's real easy to do. You just follow the link in the description, become a patron. All right. Well, I'm Fran. I'll see you around here real soon. Bye!